of you participating with us even in this virtual space. And we're very excited today to welcome our superintendent. As many of you know, there has been tremendous discussion over the last 24 hours about the return to schools in person and live instruction. And I'm sure that he'll be wanting to share that with you, weigh in with you as well. You'll be the first group that he is addressing in terms of the business community about this impact. So with that, just a couple of little reminders. Please keep your microphones on mute. If you're having any bandwidth issues or if your cameras are a little bit lagging, we sometimes encourage you to turn off the video portion. You can still hear everything. This is being recorded and will be available on our YouTube channel at Gables Communications, probably a little bit later today. I want to thank all of you for registering in advance. We use the registration format so that we can have people RSVP and then they are let into the Zoom in the waiting room. So thank you all for your patience with that today. We're very much looking forward to being able to do this in person soon, but at this moment, we are still using a virtual platform and being socially distant. We have a great slate of programs planned for you in October, including our week of welcome or our WOW week, which is celebrating our chamber's 95th anniversary, and of course, our new space. And I can't wait to show that off to many of you. With that, it's my pleasure to welcome the chair of our trustee diplomats who works with our trustee council. This is his second tour of duty. And so I know many of you are very well acquainted with Eric Gros Dubois. He is with EPGB Business Law, who is our partner and sponsor today. Eric is also a GEM member of our chamber and a member of our executive committee and board of directors. And he's also a devoted member and leader of our chamber. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Eric Gros Dubois.
Thank you so much, Mark. I couldn't have said it better myself. I was just thinking how many hats I'm wearing as we start this today. So I guess I'm going to wear the hat of the chair of the trustee diplomats. I know we have most of our diplomats in attendance. So thank you, everyone. I'm really excited. I wish we were in person, but of course, we're going to make the most of this. We have a fantastic speaker. It couldn't be more timely, considering many of us are parents and are very concerned about the school situation. And of course, we will look forward to doing this in person as soon as the time presents itself. So once again, my name is Eric Gros Dubois. My goal is to have us out of here a little after 1 o'clock. And so hopefully you guys can sit back. You brought your brown bag lunches and we will have a great presentation. So thank you so much. So a couple of things to talk about. The chamber has a new home. If you're not aware, it's right over there on Alhambra. I have not personally had an opportunity to visit, but I received the invitation today from Mark. So I will be visiting next Thursday, the 8th. I believe there's an open house. So welcome week is of course the week of October 5th to the 9th. Also, we have our first 30 days of school and it is of course Hispanic Heritage Month. So a lot of things going on. So I'd like to take a moment to recognize some of the special folks on our Zoom today. We have Brian Bearcat, my dear friend who invited me to the chamber many years ago. Bearcat Law, he's our chairman. He just ran a very effective and efficient board meeting. Thank you for getting us out on time, Brian. We also have Anna Chowie of Grove Bank and Trust. She is our chair-elect. We'll be looking forward to her year starting next September. Of course, we have our immediate past chairs, Patrick O'Connell. Thank you for everything you've done of Berkshire Hathaway Home Services, EWM Realty. Of course, we have past chairs, Carolina Rendero of Connect to Global and of our honorary consul to Portugal, and Martha de la Peña Rojas from Florida Blue. Of course, this couldn't be done without the support of our key investors. So if you just give me a minute, I'm going to recognize our GEM investors. These are the highest level of participation in the chamber. So thank you so much for your continued support. We have Amerant Bank, Berkshire Hathaway Home Services, EWM Realty. That's just one company, by the way. City National Bank, Compass, Doctors Hospital, a part of Baptist Health, East Ridge at Cutler Bay, EPGD Business Law, Equitable Advisors, Florida Blue, Florida Power and Light, Grove Bank and Trust, Mercedes-Benz of Coral Gables, the Miami Heat and the AA Arena, Miami-Dade County, Sir and Associates, Sora Global Insurance and Consulting LLC, the Alan Morris Company, the one and only Biltmore Hotel, Total Health Restoration, Dr. Michael Foreman, DOMPA, U Health, and the University of Miami. So thank you to all of our GEM investors. For those of you who don't know, GEM stands for George E. Merrick. We also have a number of trustee diplomats in attendance. Back in the olden days, they would have a table with their sign on it. So today, thank you for participating. We have Gonzalo Acevedo of Back Florida Bank, Giselle Bretto of Best Practices Title, Zach Evangelista of Sir & Associates, Carlos Garrido of Sandler Training Miami, and Mitch Mandler of SMGQ Law. Now I'd like to introduce fellow diplomat Gonzalo Acevedo, Division Head of Back Florida Bank, to lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance and share a thought of the day. So I'm going to ask all of you to stand, and we're going to put an American flag on the screen.
Wonderful. Thank you, Eric, and good afternoon to everyone. And thank you to the Coral Gables Chamber of Commerce for this honor. So I'll lead you through the Pledge of Allegiance. If you will repeat after me, please. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you. And appropriately enough, I selected a quote about teachers. It comes from Scott Hayden. It's a rather famous quote, and it goes like this. Great teachers have three loves: the love of learning, the love of learners, and the love of bringing the first two loves together. I know that in this time of COVID, it's been hard on teachers, administrators, and staff, and I'm sure we have all their support, or all of our support, behind them. And now I'll turn it over back to you, Eric. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. That was perfect. Great thought of the day. So what we're going to do, guys, is 5 minutes of networking. We're going to organize breakout rooms. Eric is going to take charge. So 5 minutes, I recommend we share some contact information, maybe set up some one-to-ones, whether it be virtual or in person, as you feel comfortable, for sometime soon. So let's make the most of it. Erica, take it away.
Hey, everyone.
Good morning.
Good morning. Yeah. They put me in a room by myself, so I left.
Yeah, me too.
Me too.
I was looking at a full view screen of myself, and I was like, something is not right here.
I said the same thing. I'm like, okay, it's just me. That's it.
Yeah. Hey, guys, I'm going to start throwing you guys in rooms. Hold on.
It's okay. We like each other.
Well, you guys can stay here if you want.
Yeah, no, I'm fine with that.
It's fine.
Let's do it. All right. I'm gonna have Nicholas be our trusty diplomat. So, Nicholas, why don't you lead us through?
All right. Hi, guys. Let's all kind of introduce ourselves. Just a 10-second commercial. Just say your name, who you are, and who you want to meet. I'll start. I'm Nicholas Aterovich, financial advisor with Edward Jones. And I like to meet attorneys and doctors. Daryl, you want to go next?
Yes, sir.
Thank you, Nick. Daryl Rosenbaum, Bigfoot Construction. We are a residential construction company specializing in impact windows and residential interiors. We're looking to meet architects and homeowners. Thank you.
Okay, great. Jacqueline?
Hi, Jackie Cocopardo. I do community relations over at Doctors Hospital, part of Baptist Health South Florida, and happy to be here with everyone.
Very welcome. Audrey?
Hey, Audrey Otero, Banco ZK, here in the Gables on Ponce. And Daryl, actually, I need your information because somebody has just asked me for impact windows. So, terrific. Well, nice to see everybody.
Thanks for this happening at the chamber, guys. Alex Fonseca, how are you?
Hi, everybody. Alex Fonseca with Apollo Bank, also right here on Ponce. We're a small commercial bank. I manage the Gables office. I'm happy to help out with whatever banking needs you may have. Thank you.
Great. Danielle?
Hi, good afternoon. I'm Danielle Dubuc from B-Star International, and we teach healthy relationship education in schools, organizations, private entities, and so happy to be here and connect with you guys.
Great. Welcome. Carolina?
Carolina Rendero with Connect to Global, and we work with companies looking to go into the European Union and European Union coming into the U.S. market.
Great. Renee?
Hello, my name is Renee Johnson. I work with the Branches Inc. here in Miami. I'm the marketing and events coordinator. Branches specializes in ending the cycle of generational poverty, and I'm just happy to be here with everyone today.
Great. Evren, how are you?
Hey, Nick, how are you doing? How's everybody doing? From Soro Global Insurance and Consulting, we're a boutique insurance agency specializing in commercial property insurance there in Coral Gables. Good to see you all.
Yeah,
Deirdre? Great to see you.
Hi, everybody. I'm Deirdre Nero from Nero Immigration Law. I have an immigration firm in the heart of Coral Gables. And we help foreign nationals and their families come to the United States, short-term or long-term or forever. I was alone in my breakout room, so I left and came back here, and I'm glad I did. Happy to see everybody.
So the best one, by the way. Lillian, hi. Lillian, sir?
Yes, hi, everyone. I was also in my own breakout room, but I was in a timeout.
I was breaking myself out.
Hi, Sir and Associates. We are the business owner's law firm. We provide a full service to our business clients. And congratulations to the Chamber, Mark, and your team for doing really such a great job during this difficult time. And I'm looking forward to seeing the new dig soon.
Yeah.
I think we're all coming back, but Greg, you're next.
Yeah, I was in my room by myself, been introduced myself to myself. It was very interesting. But my name's Greg Barnes. I'm president of Mercedes-Benz Coral Gables, and we're celebrating 63 years here in Coral Gables, and we're your local hometown Mercedes dealership. So good to be here. Thank you. Good morning, everybody.
Wow. Maria Bird?
I see the theme. It was in a breakout room by myself, but I'm with Burr Martinez. We are a boutique accounting and tax firm providing foreign-owned companies services for their startup operations here in the U.S.
Okay, great. Chad, Lang?
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Chad Lang. I'm a partner at SMGQ Law. We're a 30-attorney full-service law firm, but my specialty is management side, labor and employments, non-competes, trade secrets, overtime, discrimination, harassment, that kind of stuff.
Hmm. Are we all back now, Mark?
I think so. It's waiting on a little update from Erica on the superintendent's arrival, so. Zach was feeling very low that he was by himself, but I have a feeling that we went into all breakout rooms of one.
Yes. No, I had one other person in my breakout room.
Me too. I was on my own in a breakout room.
I had another person, but I'm a Gemini, so I always do.
I was on my own too.
So. I was on my own, and then I went into a room of 25, and then I touched another button, and then I was back in a room with one person, and then I'm back here again. I'm just very confused.
It was great. I was just looking at my picture.
That was great. Well, guys, thank you so much. I hope you got something out of it. I had a great conversation with Mary Scott Russell from East Ridge, and I learned that her son is a second year law student, and I encouraged him to reach out to me and we can talk about his career. So we'll pick back up the schedule if that's okay with you, Mark.
That's perfectly fine. I know we're expecting the superintendent to join us about 25 after. So if you wanted to maybe push ahead before his introduction and go over the calendar, that would be great. I think everybody is back now. I see the room has 75 folks in it.
Okay, perfect. So I will skip to what we usually do at the end. So everyone, here's the upcoming calendar of events. Hold on, I just made my full screen. There we go. So upcoming calendar of events, great opportunities for continued networking and connection. Starting on Monday, October 5th at 8:30 a.m., we have Speed Networking, presented in partnership with the Aventura Marketing Council Chamber of Commerce. So that's Monday, October 5th at 8:30 a.m. Then on the 6th, the next day at 8 a.m., we have the Global Business Affairs Committee meeting. No RSVP required. If you're interested in seeing what a committee is like for the Chamber of Commerce, that's a great one to sit in on. Then we have the Red Carpet Luncheon, also on the 6th at 11:15 to 1:15, featuring our local restaurants, and this will be at the Chamber's offices at 201 Alhambra Circle. Then on the 7th, 8 a.m., we have the Small Business Committee meeting, run by, I believe, our own Zach Evangelista. Again, just feel free to join, no RSVP required. Then we have on the same day, October 7th at noon, the Reconnect Luncheon, which some of you remember years ago, I used to be the MC. It is now featuring Lillian Sir of Sir & Associates as the featured speaker. Then at 5 p.m., we have our virtual happy hour, the Wind Down Wednesday, put together by our 2030 group. And this is featuring chamber trivia and a gin-tastic treat. I'm curious to know what that is. So sip on something special and enjoy creatively crafted gin kits for two by Booyah Gastro Bar in honor of the chamber's 95th anniversary. Then on Thursday, October 8th at 8 a.m., we have the membership committee meeting. Again, please feel free, no RSVP required. Then at 10 a.m. from 10 to 4, we have the chamber's open house. Come check out the new digs. And at noon on that same day, October 8th, we have join us for a walkabout. So the chamber team will be taking to the streets to meet and greet Coral Gable businesses. One more time, the chamber's address is 201 Alhambra Circle, Suite 100. Then on Friday, October 9th from 4 to 6, we have the 95th anniversary drive-by celebration. Honk your horns, flash your lights, show your number one Coral Gables Chamber some love and drive on by. And at 5 p.m. we have a HQ ribbon cutting and chairman's reception. Tune in via Facebook Live. Of course, we are keeping it to 10 people. And then on Saturday, October 10th at 9:15 to 11, we have the Welcome Center dedication and grand opening in partnership with the Greater Miami Convention and Visitors Bureau. And lastly, we have at 11 a.m. a walking tour curated and led by Donna Spain and Mark Trowbridge. More details to come. So those are the special events we have coming up for Chamber Week. Then following that, we have some of our regular events. We have Tronos CEOs featuring Ed Williamson of Williamson's Automotive Group on Friday, October 2nd at 9 a.m. We have the book club, What Retirees Want, A Holistic View of Life's Third Age, with, I'm gonna do my best with this name, Ken Ditchwald, PhD, and Robert Morrison on Friday, October 2nd at noon. Of course, I mentioned the Reconnect on October 7th, the Wind Down Wednesday in partnership with Booyah Gastro Bar also on the 7th. We have our Good Morning Coral Gables brunch sponsored by UHealth featuring Devinder Singh, MD of the University of Miami Health System and Miller School of Medicine, Chief of the Division of Plastic Surgery and Interim Professor of Clinical Surgery. And that'll take place on Thursday, October 15th at 10 a.m. We have our Women's Business Luncheon sponsored by Jackson Health Foundation, Awaken Your Inner Superstar, How to Create a Life of Purpose, Passion and Fulfillment with Michelle Villalobos on Tuesday, October 20th. I know I'll be there for that. And of course, we have our Impact Seminar, Change Management and Leadership in Times of COVID-19 with April Donia, President of Donia HR and Staffing on Wednesday, October 21st. And of course, we have our trustee virtual luncheon next month on Wednesday, October 28th at noon. So of course, those are the events. Now, as the sponsor, I have the opportunity to introduce myself to all of you. So let me tell you a little bit about EPGD Law. So I'll start by saying that I was born in New York, raised out in Texas, did all my schooling in Washington, DC, and headed over to Miami 11 years ago. I've been practicing business law for 14 years. And what that really means is I step into the role of a general counsel and a trusted partner for my clients. My clients are mostly, not exclusively, but mostly business owners. They are entrepreneurs. They have certain special set of issues such as hiring employees, subcontractors, negotiating contracts, buying and selling things. And generally speaking, they need a good lawyer on their side. I've been really lucky through the help of many of you through the chamber. In just 7.5 years, I've grown it from just me sharing a windowless office in Bearcat's office to now I have 15 attorneys working for me spread out over 3 different offices. And the attorneys each has a slightly different specialty, but they're in 3 main groups. So I will end by saying I am one of the luckiest people because I love what I do. I wake up every single morning excited. You can ask Deirdre, I run out of the house because I'm excited to go to work. I love working with the clients. Every conversation is a new opportunity, and truthfully, it's really exciting. Mark, are we on schedule for our speaker?
Yes, sir, you can go ahead. The superintendent has joined us for his presentation, so please make his introduction.
Perfect timing. So it is now my pleasure to introduce our speaker, Miami-Dade County Public School Superintendent Alberto Carvalho. He might not remember, but he spoke to my Rotary Club maybe 7 years ago. It was a fantastic speech, so I'm really looking forward to this. So Mr. Carvalho has served as the superintendent of the Miami-Dade County Public Schools, the nation's 4th largest school system, since September 2008. He's a nationally recognized expert on educational transformation, finance, and leadership development. During his tenure, Miami-Dade County Public Schools has become one of the nation's highest performing urban school systems, receiving system-wide accreditation from Advance Ed in 2014. An instructional leader at heart, Mr. Carvalho is also the proud founder and principal of the award-winning iPreparatory Academy that has become a model of robust 21st century learning in the age of innovation and technology. He is recognized by his peers as a national voice for equity in education. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome our longtime chamber friend, Mr. Alberto Carvalho.
Good afternoon, Eric. Thank you so much for that very kind introduction. Great to see all of you, particularly you, Mark. The chamber and I have been together, attached at the hip for many, many years, certainly even before I became superintendent in 2008. So it is with both delight, pleasure, and a sense of pride that I have the opportunity to address you today. I'll try to make my remarks fairly brief and allow some time for questions. I think it would be the understatement of the year if I were to say that 2020 has been an easy year for any one of us, but certainly for education. The pandemic has had a deep impact in our culture, in our ability to educate children. And fortunately, we have dealt with some challenges that certainly could not have been predicted when we launched some of the digital platforms that we launched earlier in the year. But I'd like to take it back to where we were as a school system back in January of 2020. Seems like a different lifetime. But back in January of 2020, we began monitoring what was happening in China, what was happening in some hotspots in the country that were detecting this new version of a virus that was really having a deep impact in certain communities. We saw it emerging from a localized epidemic to a national epidemic to eventually a global pandemic. And back in January, we made the decision that we were going to elevate this issue as a top priority for our school system. And we posed the question to ourselves, not a matter of if, but when the virus hits the coast of the United States and comes to Miami, what type of impact will it have? And can we project out the worst possible of impact, the ramifications it would have on what we do and how we do it, and what steps should we take to mitigate against and provide a continuity of teaching and learning for the roughly 350,000 students we educate every single day? How will we do with our workforce? What are the systems that we need to modify, adapt to, or create anew to deal with this issue? And sure enough, as we hit the beginning of March, it was clear to us that conditions were deteriorating, not only nationally, but certainly here in the state of Florida, and in a much more accentuated way in Miami-Dade. Shortly after that, we in Miami-Dade became the epicenter of COVID in the nation. So we made the decision after ample preparation, after creating systems for online learning, to shut down all of our schools and pivot to a My School Online experience, relying on Microsoft Teams and Zooms protected through our assets in the school system. Since we had acquired over the years massive amounts of digital content, we had the ability, the opportunity to train teachers. We built accountability into the system to assure daily attendance and ensure that we had our eyes on the teaching practice delivered by our teachers. And that was our first continuity of instruction plan that we launched. Very seamless, very successful. We had devices for every single student, hotspots for those who struggle with connectivity at home. I'm sure you're aware of the fact that in our community, our great community, despite the beautiful skyline behind me and despite the beautiful streets of Coral Gables, surrounding neighborhoods, 73.4% of families live in poverty, and their children live in poverty as well. They depend on subsidized breakfast and lunch. So since the school closures, we have distributed by now in excess of 8 million meals to parents out of 50 distribution sites. And now we are expanding, ramping up for food distribution at all sites. In addition to that, we created an opportunity where we partnered with local restaurants that were struggling, and we began buying meals from the restaurants to actually take hot meals to the poorest areas in our community with the greatest concentration of children who are experiencing food insecurity. And we have done over 200,000 hot meals by putting about 45 struggling restaurants at the height of the pandemic to work. We successfully closed out last school year. We had our virtual graduations, first time ever. A lot of teary-eyed kids because they really wanted to experience a traditional graduation. But we made the best of it. And then during the summer, we prepared to actually enhance the experience. A lot of the comments we got from parents and teachers, even from students, was that our instruction continuity plan during the spring of 2020, when we shut down schools in March, was good, but it needed to be enhanced. There was too much movement between different applications, different platforms. And the question for us was, can we basically create a one-stop shop, one single platform for all of the content, all courses, for an ease of navigation and a better user experience, both for the teacher and the student? And that's what we launched into. And we did our research. We selected one entity out of the few entities approved by the state as a platform and deliverer of online curriculum. We began working with them, established the protocols for them to adapt their system to our school system. We thought we were in a good place until shortly before the school year was to start again, August 31st. And I'm sure you read the Herald, you watch the news. It was not our finest moment by far. And there were significant struggles with, quite frankly, propping up this new platform. At the same time, we experienced DDoS attacks, which hid the true problem that we were experiencing with the platform for a while. And we came to the conclusion that we needed to abandon this solution. It was not going to work for us. The entity known as K-12 recognized that it was a great vision, a great plan, but they could not deliver on it. They failed to deliver on it. So we did not exchange any funds with this company. We did not pay the company. In fact, I had made the decision as we were moving through the process, as I was developing some degree of angst over timelines, that I was not going to fully execute the contract. And that served as well, because it limited our liability. So we defaulted back. We pivoted again very quickly to the platform that teachers and students knew, with some modification, easing the traffic between applications. And that's what teachers and students currently in Miami-Dade are using. They're using a series of state-approved, standards-aligned digital content with mandatory time of teaching, for no less than 3 to 4 hours by teachers, that is monitored with a great deal of interaction. So the system's normalized, and we are experiencing once again, and for weeks now, a stable, remote teaching and learning engagement across Miami-Dade. We've experienced, much like the rest of the state, in fact, every single school system in Florida is experiencing significant FTE loss of students, with exception of one, North County, St. John's County. And the reason for that is a lot of parents have apprehensions, have concerns, have anxiety about what's next. Where we've seen the biggest dips is in the earliest grades, pre-K and kindergarten. Parents are waiting or are opting for something else. So Broward County lost 8,000 students. We are about 7,000 pupils below our projection. And the same is true across the state. We're benefiting from some provisions and safe elements that the state has provided for us that allow us to budget our school system on the basis of the original projection rather than the actual number of students that came in. Otherwise, the number of reduction in force in our community for teachers, principals would be quite dramatic. With all that said, we are now ready, based on recent action taken by the board last night, where I recommended a careful, methodical, and staggered reopening of schools beginning October 5th. And that reopening will start with the youngest kids, pre-K, K, and first grade, as well as students with disabilities who have the greatest needs and really cannot go without a face-to-face intervention based on the therapies that they require. We're very concerned about the academic regression that a lot of these kids have experienced as a result of a disrupted fourth quarter, followed by the summer, where they usually experience an academic regression, particularly experienced by the kids who are most fragile, many of whom were in crisis before the COVID crisis began. Kids in poverty, English language learners, students with disabilities, and others. And so we're gonna bring those kids in first, and progressively over the next week, between Monday the 5th and the 9th, we will populate all schools, all grade levels, all students, but as I said, in a staggered, careful, well-planned way. We believe that we'll be facing some challenges. Obviously, we're a massive workforce. Many of our teachers are aging individuals who have underlying health conditions, so we've been very active in identifying those individuals and extending ADA and extended FMLA guarantees. These are rights. We've also decided that we're going to continue to honor the choices that parents made. So this is critically important. Yeah, no matter what, only about 50% of our students are returning to the schoolhouse model, with about 50% of them continuing to get their education online through My School Online. They will have an opportunity to petition a change in modality at the end of the grading period. This is going to be done in a careful way to not exceed in any one school a 75% capacity threshold to ensure a degree of social distancing. It goes without saying that the mandatory wearing of masks will be pervasive, ubiquitous, and universal, without saying increased sanitization cycles in schools with massive amounts of supplies and electrostatic disinfectants having been bought, acquired, and distributed to schools.
with new protocols, with unidirectional hallways, with a lot more utilization of non-traditional space to maximize social distancing, different way of eating the food in the cafeteria with 6 feet separation in the classrooms, at least 3 feet of separation with masks. So it will be a different environment, but we're trying to strike a balance between the needs of many parents who really have no other choice other than to send the child to school, side by side, obviously, with a number of conditions, environmental health conditions in our community that have become satisfactory enough to meet the gating criteria that our health experts had established. So that is critically important. We assembled some of the most remarkable minds in medicine and public health, including a former Surgeon General of the United States of America, the head of pediatrics for the University of Miami, a head of epidemiologist from Florida International University, as well as others, to define the gating criteria, those elements that should be observed, such as a decreased positivity rate below 10% for 14 days in a row, heading towards 5% and eventually 3% when the risk of community spread is down to zero, a decline in hospitalizations, a decline in mortality, morbidity, ample capacity for ICU beds in hospitals, as well as a number of other criteria. All of that criteria has reached a point where, according to their expert advice, we can have a safe return to schools to the extent we follow the well-established health guidelines, CDC guidelines, and World Health advisories. And that's exactly what we will be doing. And that applies to the schools, applies to the buses, reduced capacity, have to sanitize your hands upon entering them, different protocols in terms of entering the schools, sanitization of hands as soon as they enter every single classroom, as I said, wearing of masks, and mandatory hand washing cycles throughout the day. Not gonna be easy because we know what the middle school kid can be like. Not going to be easy for we know what a kindergarten kid can be like. Just keeping a mask on them, it is difficult. So we have PPEs for those who need them by the millions. And that means masks, face shields for students with disabilities that require really intimate interaction with teachers. They'll be wearing the equivalent of what a nurse or a doctor in an emergency room would be wearing. These are different days, but we ought, as I said, attempt to strike a balance between the health reality with all the precautions and mitigations side by side with the social, emotional, mental health needs that children have. We know that isolation is not good for kids. There are deleterious effects that kids are experiencing, isolated from school. We know for a fact that child abuse is on the rise, depression is on the rise, obesity is on the rise because of this lack of social interaction between kids and their colleagues, kids and schools. Even child abuse and sex abuse is on the rise because the observers, the detectors, who are usually teachers, their own colleagues or counselors, do not have direct eyes on them, even though they are connecting through Zoom. So those are all the factors that we have to consider prior to making this momentous decision that we made last night. Now it's feverish work between now and Monday to ensure that in fact our readiness is what parents and students and teachers expect. We, as a system, just transitioned into stage two, which is slightly different from the state's phase three, almost simultaneously as the state transitioned by and large to its phase three, which is not our stage three. We will continue to collaborate with the local health department, with the state health department. If we, by the way, did not open sometime next week, we would face also the potential loss of significant funding from Tallahassee. That was not the single decision that put us where we are today, but it could not be ignored because we were talking about dozens of millions of potential impact for us, for Broward County, and for Palm Beach counties as well. So, now that I gave you all of the good news, the easy stuff, let me reassert once again as I close. Miami-Dade County Public Schools despite the challenges, is an A-rated school system for the third year in a row. Our surrounding districts are not. Miami-Dade County Public Schools can boast of the fact that for the past 4 years, it does not have a single F-rated school. Miami-Dade County Public Schools posted its highest graduation rate ever at 90% this year. 99% of our schools are rated A, B, and C. 47% of our schools are rated A, as compared to the state's 34% of schools rated A. We just received our AP data. That's data associated with college-level coursework done by students while in high school. And Miami-Dade is number one school system in the country with the highest number of students taking AP classes, but also with the highest percentage of students passing the College Board exam with a 3, 4, or 5, guaranteeing a college credit. In addition to that, Miami-Dade County Public Schools for the 9th year in a row has been designated by the United States Department of Education and Magnet Schools of America as the number one school choice district in a country with the best magnet programs anywhere in the country. And of course, this year declared by the governor and on the basis of a number of measures, including the NAEP, which is a nation's report card, the nation's assessment, where our fourth graders scored number one in the country in reading. Our fourth graders scored number one in the country in mathematics. Our eighth graders second in the country. This assessment only tests fourth and eighth graders. So whether we're talking about elementary, middle, or senior high schools, our students are punching above their weight. And this is all due to the remarkable leadership we have in this school system and the remarkable ability of the teaching workforce that we employ. And it goes without saying, one of our strongest assets is the community involvement that we benefit from in Miami-Dade. And I have to say that whether we're talking about Mark or many of you, you are in our schools, you participate, you are partners, you advise us, you help us transform ourselves into a better version of us. And that's why I'm thankful to the Coral Gables Chamber. That's why I'm thankful for the work you do and your ever presence in our schools. Thank you.
Mr. Superintendent, Mark Trowbridge here. Thank you. Thank you very much for your wonderful comments and your candor as always. Also very much appreciate you being with us here today. I know it was a long day yesterday and to the evening, and I'm sure you have been Zooming in with many folks today wanting to hear directly from you. And I know it's been a long 6+ months. Our business community is critically invested, not only in what you and your educators are doing and your leadership is doing, but also the reality that getting back to school helps us get back to work as well in a more traditional time frame and time set. So I do have a few questions for you that have come in the chat. I think you can probably see some of them, so I'll try to paraphrase. A few of them are a little bit long. You talked a little bit about the phasing and the staging, and I know they don't exactly align, but the question comes in that says, phase two is currently in implementation mode, and we are learning from that, but what might we expect in the next phase three opening and the estimated timeline in your estimation?
Sure, so the phase three will come about as a result of those gating criteria that I described actually becoming more favorable. So at phase three, you should expect a positivity rate to be at 3% or less. You would expect the viral strength, that's a total number of cases, to have dropped significantly well below 50% what it is now. Phase three will also reflect ubiquitous expedited availability of testing that's universal, with also an expectation of test results that are swift, no more than 48 hours. And I have good confidence because of the rapid tests that are being deployed right now, that that timeline is even going to be reduced further to a matter of 15 minutes or less in some cases. What that means in terms of operations of the school system, that means with phase three, all students come back to the schoolhouse unless parents opt to continue to have them on My School Online. But at that time, even phase three, even the ADA required accommodations go away. All teachers or students return to the schoolhouse. It's basically a full normalization of the educational environment. When do I think that will happen? I was in a better place to give you that answer yesterday, but yesterday we saw a spike.
We
saw the rate of positivity for COVID-19 go from the day prior, where it was below 3%, I believe it was at 2.54%, to 6.67% yesterday. So this is the difficulty. This is a virus that we by now know a lot about, but we still know very little about. Each day we come across new information about what the virus is, how it can be contracted, who's most vulnerable. And we learn this information, sadly, and this is not a political commentary, far be it from me to try to be political after one of the masterpiece debates of our lifetime last night. But it is difficult sometimes to decode true, actual scientific information about this virus because there are so many voices, some with a reputation, with the earned degree, with a research endorsement behind them, others with none of it. And it creates what shouldn't happen in America, which is a confusion about the real truth behind a real threat to the American community and certainly to children and our schools. So I cannot predict for you right now when phase three or stage three in Miami-Dade will occur. I think we're not looking into a matter of next year. I think it will happen within months, but I cannot predict it for you with all certainty.
Have we heard today's numbers, or is that something you're also waiting to hear as well?
I have not heard today's numbers. They're usually published early afternoon, so I don't know what the positivity rate is for today. We utilize from the county dashboards from the health department, so it's pretty accurate.
Are you all using your great ability to connect with parents and families about rapid testing for specific schools and communities, or is that something you're leaving to folks to make a determination on their own part? You're not requiring that, obviously, for a
reason. So, you know, actually the advice of our medical experts was not to dedicate resources to test our students. It said, test the employees, they are at greater risk. Students, unless they are exhibiting symptoms, that's not something you should rush into. Even though that advice itself has changed. Now we're in a mode in the country where everyone should be tested. We are benefiting, so let me speak about this at two levels. Number one, for our employees, months ago, we decided to make testing available for all of our employees free of charge. Mm-hmm. We are going to expedite that and actually create three testing centers at three different locations where employees can go to and get a rapid test. In addition to that, Florida is going to be one of the first recipients in the country in terms of getting some of that stock of the 150 million rapid tests that the administration announced would be distributed very soon. I spoke with the governor and Miami-Dade will be one of the first districts to receive those rapid tests. We want to bring those rapid tests into our schools. We created in every school two isolation centers, not necessarily to begin to test every student. Obviously, we would need parental consent, but it will be powerfully helpful if a child or an adult develops symptoms while in school, for them to come to isolation center, be tested, get results in 15 minutes, and at least know immediately what to do regarding contact tracing, communication, you know, investigating those who may have had contact with this person or not. One of our challenges is going to be the fact that a sneeze is no longer just a sneeze, right?
That's right.
In school. And a cough is no longer just gonna be a cough. Everything's gonna be suspicious. So the importance of these rapid tests is it affords us an opportunity to confirm or deny the suspicion specific to the symptom and immediately take actions that enact contact tracing and the automatic communication to everyone and anyone who may have had contact with that child or that professional.
What about school buses? Are those going to be running? I know folks are a little bit worried about that and just that environment as well.
Yeah, school buses will be running, but under different conditions. Number one, what we've done with school buses is we have added more buses to the routes. Secondly, reduced the capacity. That's why we had to add more buses to the routes. So there will be social distancing in the buses. The seats are marked where students can sit, where they cannot sit. The buses themselves will be sanitized in between routes. You know, we use the same bus to pick up elementary school kids and then later on middle school kids, etc. So for any bus that's used multiple times throughout the day for the pickups and drop-offs, the buses are sanitized, and then every single bus via a private sector contractor is deeply sanitized every single night. In addition to that, and beyond the social distancing, every bus has been outfitted with a hand sanitizer at the entrance. So before students board the bus, they pump sanitizer into their hands. And of course, everybody will be wearing a mask on the bus. The bus drivers themselves will be driving sort of in a cocoon with a plastic partition for their protection and for the students' protection, much like you've seen maybe in metro school buses.
So you mentioned masks a couple times during your comments. One of our parents asked, you know, children with disabilities may not be as capable or as comfortable wearing a mask. How will you all handle
ways? We recognize that not only students with disabilities, but there may be some students who have an underlying condition, a respiratory condition, where they may not be able to physically wear a mask, or a teacher. So we need to have alternatives for that. The face shield is an alternative for students who are in a condition. Acrylic partitions may be an alternative, even though some people are spending a lot of money on acrylic partitions. For cases where the virus, if it's present, is aerosolized, meaning it's so it's clustered in such small particles that flow in the air naturally, the acrylic partition means nothing because you cannot put the person in the cube, right? I mean, it's a three-way partition. The same challenge with a face, the visor, the face shield. It only affords a certain degree of protection. It actually is a better protector for mucus contact of the virus than anything else. The best defense is the mask. But for those who can't, that's where I referenced, additional extreme PPE for employees who may be dealing with children whose disabilities may prevent them from wearing a mask, or in some cases where you have children who have a lack of control of their own functions, so they may create a greater risk. In these cases, the teachers, the paraprofessionals, the individuals in those classrooms, which usually are very, very small size, will be wearing the equivalent of, extreme PPE, much like you would see in a hospital setting in an emergency room. We're talking about the gown, the face mask, the visor, head protection, gloves, etc.
So a question from a parent who's also a member of our chamber says that their child's school is having separate virtual and in-person classes varying by subject. So this member's child is going back in person, but what happens if they were to come back and test positive, or someone in their household? Will they be able to still join the virtual class while they are in quarantine? They are under the understanding that some of those classes are capped and at capacity, and we're told there couldn't be any switching.
No, so if it's a public school, I don't know if it's a public or private, but if it's a public school, as I said, exclusive of any extreme circumstances like the case you described where somebody gets sick, the parents can opt to change the modality at the end of the grading period.
Okay.
But if a child gets sick or for whatever reason needs to be quarantined, then yes, one of the benefits of us having an MSO, a Miami School Online, is that they do not have to lose access to learning. They can be defaulted in that case to Miami School Online. In fact, that is our approach for cases that no doubt we will face. I mean, I'm not ever going to be in a position of telling the truth. We will have cases, employees or students, or relatives of students, right? Siblings or parents who will be infected symptomatically or not. And we will have to engage in contact tracing. And yes, there will be cases where you may have to quarantine an entire classroom, right? You may have to quarantine a number of classrooms, or you may have to shut down a school depending on how pervasive it is. And the solution then is obviously to default, albeit for a period of time, those students into the My School Online approach rather than depriving them of any education whatsoever.
So that's a good segue to the question of what you're talking about, maybe sort of these doomsday scenarios. And so I appreciate you talking about them very openly, because everybody knows that when you're talking about the gating criteria, you're looking at it in all dimensions. But is there a criteria for where you'd have to suddenly pivot back to only virtual? We saw that back in July with some of our businesses. So
absolutely. So the bridge out of phase one into phase two is the same bridge back to phase one.
Okay.
So if we begin to see, so just, look at the gating criteria from the flip side. If we begin to see, and this is something that I will not waver from, if we begin to see environmental health conditions in our community that we determine in consultation with our medical and public health experts are not appropriate for children and our workforce to be in schools, then we reverse course. And obviously that would be a significant increase in the positivity rates above 10% for 14 days. That should get everyone's attention, not just the school system, right? Monitoring the hospitalization rate in local hospitals, if that increases progressively, dramatically, if we begin to see the ICU bed capacity nearing depletion because of COVID cases, if the viral strength gains in numbers, meaning the total number of people who have COVID-19, if you see those elements moving in that direction, then the trend naturally would predict a significant action on our part. And I would think that the mayors will be taking appropriate actions as well. That's the only prudent thing to do.
So a question from another parent talking that some of our students are at schools that are a little bit older, maybe don't have brand new AC systems or the best ventilation as right. Some of our newer schools. How are you attacking sort of that challenge? Is it air purifiers? Are you using different systems? You talk about how you're sanitizing school buses, so you have a lot of resources there that you're utilizing. Any thoughts on that?
So we've bought thousands of powerful equipment to ensure the disinfection of schools. So we've delivered in excess of, I believe, close to 1,000 Titan disinfected sprayers to schools. We have the first shipment of 100 of 900 electrostatic disinfectors. The first 100 are going to be provided to high schools, and 50 of them, and the other 50, because these are the largest buildings, the other 50 are going to be deployed into three regions to be utilized by schools on as they need it. In addition to that, we spent the entire summer changing in excess of 46,000 filters. Mm-hmm. We're progressively making improvements to MERV 13 rated filters, which are filters, high capacity filters, that filter out the smallest of particles. However, one of the challenges that we have is, as you said, a number of our schools are old. And even though we've made remarkable progress with our bond, which has made a great deal of investment in HVAC systems, you cannot just, retrofit every single filter with a MERV 13 filter, because a lot of air conditioning units do not have the capacity to blow through that level of thickness of filter. So that requires changing the entire AC unit. So this is work in progress. We have determined which schools, and we have about, out of our 400 schools, about 30 schools that really are a concern for us, because they were designed as bunkers. So they are basically windowless. And we are deploying a number of strategies, including additional ventilation from the outside with rented units that bring more fresh air into the school, having redundant systems in case there is a power outage that brings down the AC system, as well as the intensification of disinfection of those classrooms and those schools. In addition to that, we have on order for those schools, and we hope it gets here very, very soon, air purifiers, some of them ionic purifiers, some of them ultraviolet machines that basically have the ability to purify the air. But look, none of these are, none of these come with 100% guarantees. And the best protection is actually the cheapest protection, which is a face mask, washing your hands often, detecting your own behaviors and identifying any symptoms prior to leaving school. We have an application that every employee logs into and declares their fitness for work that day online. So we pick it up even before the person leaves the house. We are distributing, I believe I said earlier, maybe not, infrared thermometers to every single family in Miami-Dade. So those are easy steps that can be taken in addition to the more difficult transformations that we are in the process of accomplishing in some problematic schools because of the issue we're dealing with at this point.
Mr. Superintendent, I know you need to head out to the next thing on your plate, which is already overflowing. I want to thank you for your support of our restaurants, the work that you did to support them early on. Many cases, many of them were able to survive because of their work with the school system. And obviously, we want to encourage you to continue to do that. Thank you for feeding our families, many of them who have unfortunately found themselves in a crisis because of this pandemic. And thank you for your leadership. So many of our members just want to say a personal thank you. You're a voice of calm, a voice of reason. Your thoughts today, I think, were just terrific and informative and just very candid. You laid it out for folks, and we're going to be there standing shoulder to shoulder with you on October 5th, Mr. Superintendent. So thank you.
Thank you so much, Mark. Thank you, Eric, for sponsoring today's event and to the entire membership of this great organization. I really thank you for your time and your patience through these trying times for us. And, you know, there is light at the end of the tunnel, and there are better days ahead. And I know that for us, for our state, for our country. And politics are important, but the politics of science should have no place in dictating the practice of what's in the best interest of communities. I cannot divorce myself from that for, you know, I was not trained as an educator. I was trained as a scientist who defaulted into education. So for me, as you know, Mark, I am driven by reason first and foremost, but sometimes now we need to balance that out with the exigent needs of our community. And it is important to restart the economy, but we have to do it in a prudent, careful way that too is guided by science. So once again, thank you so much. God bless you all and have a fantastic day.
Alberto, thank you. And Eric, we turn it back to you to close our program. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you so much. Alberto, I will tell you that it was, believe it or not, November 21st, 2013, when you spoke to my Rotary Club. So my, how the time has changed. Although you still have all your hair, I lost all mine. So thank you so much for a wonderful presentation. And thank you to all of us, all of you who attended this great luncheon. Of course, we'd rather be in person, but this is as close as we can get for now. So one more time, coming up October 5th, we've got a whole week of chamber events to celebrate the new offices at 201 Alhambra Circle, Suite 100. So please come on by. Don't forget your mask and your hand sanitizer, but it'd still be great to see you. And of course, the rest of the regular chamber events. So thank you again from my firm, EPGD Business Law, for the opportunity to sponsor. And for those of you who I can call a friend, thank you again. Thank you, Mark. And of course, Erica, for putting this together. Everyone have a wonderful chamber day.
Thank you.
Bye, everybody. Outstanding. Congratulations.